From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Hello, and welcome to this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. I am your host, Dr. Revital Marcus, JAMA Fishbein Fellow and Neurologist. Today I will be speaking with Dr. Rodrigo Hasbun. Dr. Hasbun is an infectious disease specialist and professor of medicine in the McGovern Medical School at the University of Texas Health Science Center in Houston. We will be discussing the review article written by Dr. Hasbun on bacterial meningitis, published in the December 6, 2022 issue. The majority of meningitis cases are aseptic meningitis, caused by viruses, with bacterial and fungal meningitis each causing fewer than 10% of total meningitis cases. However, bacterial meningitis is a medical emergency and has a high rate of morbidity and mortality. Fortunately, the incidence of bacterial meningitis has decreased due to childhood vaccination. Various bacterial pathogens are common in adult and pediatric populations. In adults, the most common causes are Streptococcus pneumonia and Neisseria meningitidis, and in neonates, the most common causes are Group B strep, E. coli, and Listeria. Listeria is also a cause of bacterial meningitis in adults older than age 50 who are immunocompromised. When bacterial meningitis is suspected, treatment with empiric IV antibiotics is started as soon as possible. Dr. Hasbun is an expert in meningitis, and we are fortunate to have him here today to bring our listeners up to date on this important topic. Dr. Hasbun, thank you for joining us on the podcast today.
Thank you, Dr. Marcus.
Let's start by discussing the incidence and morbidity and mortality rates of bacterial meningitis and how these have changed in the past few decades with the introduction of vaccination.
So yes, the incidence of bacterial meningitis has definitely decreased in the countries where routine vaccination is given for Streptococcus pneumoniae, Neisseria meningitidis, and H. influenza. The neurological morbidity and mortality, though, continues to be high, especially in countries that are underdeveloped, in low-income and middle-income countries. In high-income countries, the mortality has significantly decreased with the use of adjunctive dexamethasone in the last 20 years, especially in the pneumococcal meningitis cases.
What are the risk factors for contracting bacterial meningitis in the community, including Listeria outbreaks?
So for Listeria monocytogenous meningitis, the main risk factors is being immunosuppressed, typically the cellular immunodeficiency like AIDS, steroid recipient, recent chemotherapy, or solid organ transplantation. There's been Listeria outbreaks related to contaminated produce, and there's been several outbreaks linked to different produce in different areas of the world. The most recent outbreak occurred in South Africa and had a high number of cases. For pneumococcal or meningococcal meningitis, the risk factors also include AIDS, but also alcoholism, diabetes, and cancer in older age and other immunosuppressive conditions.
And what are the most common symptoms of bacterial meningitis? And can you please speak to the triad of fever, stiff neck, and altered mental status that many of us are familiar with as a diagnostic clue?
The classic triad of fever, stiff neck, and change in mental status is only present in 41% of patients with acute bacterial meningitis. This has been documented by large prospective studies done in the Netherlands. So other symptoms that patients can have are headache, nausea, vomiting, and sometimes a petechial rash, especially in cases of meningococcal meningitis. Patients may present with altered mental status, cranial nerve palsies, and sometimes even focal deficits.
So putting that into context, that really only 41% of individuals who end up having bacterial meningitis will present with that triad of fever, stiff neck, and altered mental status. What is the best way to go about suspecting the diagnosis?
In the largest prospective bacterial meningitis study to date in the Netherlands, there was a study published in the New England Journal of Medicine that included 696 patients. And in that study, 95% of the patients had two out of four symptoms: fever, headache, stiff neck, or altered mental status. So if you have those two out of four symptoms, you should definitely consider bacterial meningitis in your differential and consider doing a spinal tap. Unfortunately, the meningeal signs are very insensitive in picking up or figuring out which patients are going to have meningitis.
Now, in addition to the physical exam and, of course, eliciting a history, there's lab testing, and then you mentioned a lumbar puncture, so we're looking at the cerebrospinal fluid composition. That all helps with the diagnosis. What is the potential role of biomarkers and PCR testing for diagnosing and choosing treatment for bacterial meningitis?
To distinguish viral from bacterial meningitis is definitely a very important decision clinicians have to make, because a lot of the times patients with viral meningitis are treated with antibiotics for 3 days while you wait for the cultures. And in the overall probability of having viral versus bacterial meningitis, the majority of the patients are going to end up having viral meningitis. So there is a risk score that was just published that looks at factors that are available upon clinical presentation that could help you decide if the patient, you should be worried about bacterial meningitis. And those are a CSF white count that's elevated of greater than 2,200, or an absolute neutrophil count of greater than 1,180, a low glucose, a high serum white count, and fever. Those factors should clue you in that you're dealing with bacterial meningitis. But there are other biomarkers that have been used in the literature that could also help, like CSF lactate, especially if it's greater than 4, a serum procalcitonin. And most recently, we've had a multiplex PCR that's now available and FDA approved that can detect viral pathogens and bacterial pathogens within a couple hours. So that can also help you determine the etiology of your meningitis, so you would treat accordingly to those results.
With regards to the multiplex PCR and the serum procalcitonin, are these things that are being used in practice currently?
So definitely the multiplex PCR has been now FDA approved for 7 years and is widely used in the majority of the hospitals now. So it has become a tool that is frequently used. Procalcitonin has been used, but much less, because it's a send-out test, and really you want a quick test to tell you what the probability is of having viral versus bacterial meningitis. So in summary, the multiplex is definitely being used much more frequently right now, and is definitely of a big benefit for clinicians to make an informed decision about their patient.
With the biomarkers, what is the risk of waiting to start the antibiotics after receiving the lumbar puncture CSF?
So the Infectious Disease Society of America, or the IDSA guidelines, the European guidelines, the Scandinavian guidelines, and the UK guidelines, they all basically say the same thing. You should start with antibiotic therapy and adjunctive dexamethasone if your suspicion of bacterial meningitis is high, before you get the CSF. Then once you have your CSF, then you determine if you're going to continue the antibiotics and the steroids based on what the CSF shows. So if the CSF looks like viral meningitis and the PCR in a couple hours tells you that it's an enterovirus, you can definitely stop the antibiotic therapy and the steroid therapy. But it's very important to start promptly antibiotic therapy and promptly steroid therapy, because that is where the benefit lies. If you delay the use of antibiotic therapy in bacterial meningitis, that is associated with increased mortality in those patients. Also, with steroids, the recommendation is to give it 15 minutes before the first dose of the antibiotic therapy. So that decision has to be done before the spinal tap.
For many clinicians, it's common practice to do brain imaging prior to the lumbar puncture to screen for possible risk of herniation during the lumbar puncture. Can you please address when brain imaging should be done with respect to the lumbar puncture?
So this was one of my first studies that I did when I was a fellow. We actually followed 301 adults with suspected meningitis in the emergency room, and we did the neurological exam before they got the CT and the LP. And in that study, we were able to identify the factors associated with a normal CT that were basically being immunocompromised, having a history of CNS disease, such as a brain tumor or stroke, new onset seizures, papilledema, altered mental status, and focal neurological deficits, all with a very quick neurological exam. It took less than 10 minutes. And in 2004, the IDSA, the Infectious Disease Society of America guidelines, incorporated those factors into their guidelines. So if you have those factors present, you should then do a CAT scan before your spinal tap. But that patient should receive the antibiotics and the steroids before they go to CAT scan. If you don't have any of those factors, then the patient should go ahead and get the spinal tap without a screening CAT scan. Since the 2004 guidelines were published, now the European, the United Kingdom, and the Scandinavian guidelines have been published with more strict criteria to get a CAT scan. Unfortunately, even though these guidelines have been published now for almost two decades, there's still a lot of overuse of CAT scans in suspected meningitis in the emergency room. We actually did a follow-up study, and we found that the majority of patients, around two-thirds of the patients that got a CT in patients with meningitis, had no indication to get the CAT scan. And still, they got a CT, and the CT didn't show much. There was only two patients that had minor intracranial abnormalities that did not change management. So it's very important to try to only use CT scans in patients that have a clear indication for it. Otherwise, we're basically doing CAT scans unnecessary, and we're increasing cost, radiation, and delays in doing the spinal tap on those patients.
I do want to circle back to treatment. And you had mentioned earlier that when bacterial meningitis is suspected, one starts IV antibiotics together with IV dexamethasone. Can you speak a little bit to when IV dexamethasone should be added? Or am I to understand that it should always be added to antibiotics?
So typically, the clinical trials that were done that showed an impact in mortality were done in high-income countries. And the dexamethasone in those studies basically was given 15 minutes before the dose of antibiotic. The logic behind that is that basically you're given this steroid before the bactericidal antibiotic. The bactericidal antibiotic basically is going to kill the bacteria, release cell wall components that are going to generate cytokines. And the cytokines are the one that's going to generate this cerebral edema that's going to be associated with neurological morbidity and mortality and brain herniation. So the ideal is to give it before the first dose of antibiotics. The United Kingdom guidelines and the European guidelines have different recommendations. So the European guidelines, and again, based on just expert opinion, they say the steroids could be given up to 4 hours after the first dose of antibiotics. And the UK guidelines say up to 12 hours. That's based on a retrospective study that was done in critical care medicine 2003 that showed that use of steroids up to 12 hours was associated with decreased mortality in pneumococcal meningitis. Again, a retrospective study, 123 patients. But the clinical trial data all basically says to do it with the first dose of antibiotic therapy. So it has to be given early. Which patients benefit? So in pediatrics, the main benefit was seen in H. influenza, where there was a decrease in hearing loss in kids. Fortunately, we are not seeing H flu anymore. And there's no study that have proven that steroids benefit pneumococcal or other types of bacterial meningitis in children. That's why if you look at the current literature, only around 8% of patients with bacterial meningitis in kids are getting steroids. In contrast, in adults, pneumococcal meningitis, there's clear evidence for decreased mortality. There's a study from Dietrich van der Beek in the Netherlands just published this year over the last 20 years showing a clear decrease in mortality with the use of steroids in that country. In their group, they also saw a decrease in mortality and neurological morbidity in patients with meningococcal meningitis as well. In contrast, in Listeria monocytogenous meningitis, the French study that was published several years ago in the Lancet Infectious Diseases showed increased mortality with steroids. So now the recommendation is to give it for all types of bacterial meningitis in adults in high-income countries, but to back off if it's Listeria. And Listeria is an uncommon cause of bacterial meningitis. It only accounts for around 2% of cases. So the majority of the patients will have some benefit with steroids, but again, it has to be given early.
Can you talk a little bit about the morbidity and mortality over the last few decades in bacterial meningitis?
Yes. So the mortality in bacterial meningitis really varies by pathogen and by country. So with the advent of adjunctive dexamethasone in high-income countries, the mortality has dropped to around 6%. In Germany, in pneumococcal meningitis. It continues to be as high as 54% in countries such as Malawi in Africa. The reason behind the lack of impact of steroids in low-income countries is that patients come in very sick. They're coming in with a delayed presentation. A lot of them already are having seizures or coma, and steroids are really going to only be effective early in the disease process of bacterial meningitis. Also, neurological morbidity and mortality vary by pathogen. The pathogen associated with the highest morbidity and mortality is Streptococcus pneumoniae, followed by Haemophilus influenza, and then Neisseria meningitis that has the lowest neurological morbidity and mortality. The risk factors for bad outcome, including morbidity and mortality, include age, the older patients, hypotension and seizures, all in an initial study that was published by Steve Aronin in 1998. And then other risk scores have been developed that looked at no pre-admission antibodies can come, and then pneumonia, purpuric rash, lower GCS scores, focal neurological deficits, low CSF pleocytosis, and positive blood culture. So there's all these risk scores that have been developed to try to stratify the risk that somebody's going to actually have a bad outcome with bacterial meningitis. And they can be used to try to assess the need for those patients to be admitted to an intensive care unit and have more close monitoring.
Dr. Hasbun, thank you again for joining us today to discuss this important topic.
Thank you very much, Dr. Marcus. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you to all our listeners. I want to remind the listeners that further details may be found in the review article written by Dr. Hasbun on bacterial meningitis published in the December 6th, 2022 issue of JAMA. This episode was produced by Shelley Steffens at the JAMA Network. The audio team here also includes Jesse McQuarters, Daniel Morrow, Lisa Harden, Audrey Foreman, and Mary Lynn Furkeluk. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thank you for listening.